inviting you me for such an important conversation. I'm working with the PRIA. It's a participatory research in Asia, and we are closely working with network of civil society organizations across India and abroad. In my deliberations, I am going to touch upon like how what is the institutional response as the institution responses in dealing with the challenges posed by the pandemic. So I'm more talking about the grassroots local governance institutions like our panchayats, the way they have coped up with the response to COVID situation. And I'm going to share some of the examples from different parts of the country. And also suggest some recommendations like how to deal with such kind of situations in the future. All these the points I'm going to discuss right now are based on our experience of last 1.5 year by interacting with the various local government elected representatives and also the civil society organizations, those who are working closely with the local government institutions. Thank you very much again, and I will try to keep my presentation for 15 minutes or maybe 10 minutes because it's already 3 past 5, and I will take some questions after that. First of all, I will like to present the case of Kerala. Like now we are in the second phase, in the second stage or second wave of COVID, though Kerala is experiencing a lot of cases, but that have a different kind of story. I will also throw some light on that. But if you look at the Kerala experience during the first wave of COVID and how the local government institutions in especially the Gram Panchayats in Kerala have take up this thing and very well, they have managed it very well. If you look at the Kerala experience, so they have developed the community-based disaster management plans in 2018 itself, and all the panchayats in Kerala, they have this community-based disaster management plan as a part of their Gram Panchayat plans, and they are extensively creating a database and collecting ward-based data on shelter management, hospital infrastructure, technical resource persons, trained health workers, and this helped them immediately in response to the pandemic. And the support of local representatives, local committees, health department, police department, revenue department, and other community-based organizations are very crucial in their response. So as Dr. Emmy is just referring to, like the coordinated efforts are required at the grassroots level. In many of the states, these coordinated efforts are somehow we have seen that these coordinated efforts are missing, and most of the burden of managing COVID is on either on the health department or the district state disaster management authority and the district disaster management authorities. The other experience is from like from Kanuriya Gram Panchayat Bhuj in Gujarat, where this when we interacted with this panchayat president or panchayat sarpanch, so he has shared with us that how this Kanuriya Gram Panchayat has managed this first wave of COVID, and they have quickly able to set up community kitchens, quarantine facilities, and spreading authentic information to the communities, and they have involved all the self-help groups, local communities, frontline workers, and they started working in managing the influx of migration during the first wave. As we are well aware of that, during the first, there are like differences we have seen that during the first wave, it's mostly the pandemic is mostly restricted to the big cities in the cities, and that's why the migration has started. The lockdown is another reason for the migration, but many cases in the cities is also a reason for the migration. And a lot of this migration when it started happening towards the villages, so the Panchayati Raj institutions, there is a like a blanket kind of orders where Panchayati Raj institutions have been asked in most of the states to set up quarantine centers, to take care of migration, to get them registered, and all these work have been assigned to them. But hardly any state has provided the resource to the Gram Panchayats to manage all those things. And when the 15th Finance Commission has released its first year money, in which they have mentioned that 50% of the this money can be spent on management of COVID activities. So many of the Gram Panchayats have got this assurance that they can spend out of this 50% of the 15th Finance Commission grant. But that also delayed by almost like 4 or 5 months. And by the time all the villages, all the Gram Panchayats, you look at any of these states, so they are facing the huge challenges. But still, for example, if you look at Bihar, many of the Gram Panchayats and state has taken some initiatives, and they have asked Panchayats to get all the migrants get registered. And they also started the skill mapping of all the migrants. So when they've assigned with this thing, they want to try to create a database of migrants, those who are skilled in any kind of work. And when we say that the skill and unskilling thing, I think, and we firmly believe that nobody is unskilled on this earth. Even the sweeper, even the maid, those who are coming to our homes, even if they are doing jharu pocha, it's a skilled job. And these panchayats, when started this skill mapping, the idea is to create a job opportunities even at the village level itself. But when the lockdown is over, we have seen there is again the reverse migration from villages to the cities, and cities are already facing challenging in terms of like labor force. So again, this has started, and when we have confronted with the second wave it started in March this year, and it's on peak in April and May. So it is mostly on the health pressure is on the health system, which was not in the first wave. So then we have realized that unless these local government institutions and the frontline health workers are efficiently equipped with the proper health kind health infrastructure and all these things, we are not able to manage any of such pandemic things. So the idea is basically, if you look at the local governance institutions, so. And if you want to really strengthen the local government institutions, we have to learn from these state experiences and the various initiatives which was taken by the states. And looking at the response of the panchayats, if you want to scale up those responses to the state or to the national level, it is important that we need to understand, we need to, first of all, though we know that like panchayats are at the heart of the community, and they need to be at the center of future social and economic development planning. So unless we recognize, though Gram Panchayat development planning is happening in almost all the states, but it is not, it becomes an annual ritual exercise. We are not taking this convergence or coordinated efforts from various departments in the Gram Panchayat development plans, and these are mostly linked to the infrastructure thing. So after learning experiences from this pandemic, we need to understand that the panchayats should also focus on the social and health this thing, and also be instrumental in preparing the disaster mitigation plans. And the other thing is that the pandemic is another, like, taught us that Panchayati Raj institutions need to be strengthened and enabled to take action even after the pandemic. So it's a learning for us. It's a learning for all the institutions, and the economic emergency will continue as there has been a loss of livelihood for a large number of people. So we also need to create some kind of buffer, how to deal with all these situations. And the third point is, like Dr. Emmy has also raised that, like CSOs, and after the FCRA amendments in September last year, many of the CSOs have they are very instrumental in providing relief and support during the first wave, but during the second wave, they are facing big challenges in dealing with all these issues. So we have also undertaken a nationwide survey in June, July this year, and we have reached out to almost like 583 civil society organizations, from larger to small civil society organizations, and we have tried to capture the response, the kind of support these civil society organizations have provided during the second wave. So if I briefly explain you, like almost like 91% of the civil society organizations are providing the personal hygiene materials, and 78% of the civil society organizations are providing the food material. 73% of the civil society organizations are providing medical support. And if you look at the kind of the way the information is being provided by these civil society organizations, so if you will find that 74% of the civil society organizations are actually disseminating the information by door-to-door campaign or by distributing IEC material. So this is the power of civil society organizations and how they have helped the communities in dealing with the second wave and the trauma of weak health facilities and how to cope up with the second wave of pandemic. And Dr. Emmy has also very rightly said that the situation of women, and especially the adolescent girls and women, is very pathetic during this the entire period of this pandemic. And we have seen that again there are like reports that the child marriages, trafficking, violence against women is increasing, and we are also working with the domestic workers and a network of domestic workers, and we also found that they are also facing as any other migrant workers. But being a woman, there is an additional burden and an additional risk on their entire this dignity as well as on the livelihood opportunities. So as a civil society organizations, we also need to look at like how to bring this our experiences, what we have learned, we are learning from the field, to the policy level as well as to the grassroots level, to the local governance institutions, and how they can be strengthened through our efforts. So these are the few things I would like to share, and I'm open to take any questions.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much for your deliberations. We are